Good morning. I'm Calvin Samuel, Methodist minister for the Essex towns of Hockley, Rochford and Rayleigh on the edge of Southend. Welcome to this Covenant Community online service. We are internationally dispersed, but we come together in worship as a covenant community. We can never be sure where life will take us. Sometimes we end up in unexpected places and situations wondering, how did we get here? Years ago, as a student in London, I was running down the stairs of the university library only to discover that the Queen was on her way up. Accompanied by Prince Philip, various dignitaries and university higher-ups. Presumably for security concerns, they hadn't advertised this widely, so I had no idea she was in the building. I had to retrace my steps back up the stairs and allow the royal party to pass by. That's probably as close to royalty as I've ever got, and probably ever will. As we continue our journey today into the Book of Acts, we discover that Paul had a similarly unexpected opportunity to bear witness to King Agrippa. Our first hymn today is a prayer for guidance to the God who knows our future, however unexpected it may be. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. Please, please do sing along at home. Please respond using the words in yellow on your screen or the text in bold type if you're listening on audio and working from a transcript. Let us pray. God, our judge and saviour, teach us to be open to your truth and to trust in your love, that we may live each day with confidence in the salvation which is given through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us make our confession to God. We say together, O King, enthroned on high, filling the earth with your glory, holy is your name, Lord God Almighty. In our sinfulness, we cry to you to take our guilt away and to cleanse our lips to speak your word. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In silence, let's bring personal confessions to God. The Almighty and merciful Lord grant you pardon and forgiveness of all your sins, time for amendment of life, and the grace and strength of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks be to God. Our scripture readings today pick up where we left off last week, beginning in Acts chapter 26.
Agrippa said to Paul, "You have permission to speak for yourself." Then Paul stretched out his hand and began to defend himself. "I consider myself fortunate that it is before you, King Agrippa, I am to make my defence today against all the accusations of the Jews, because you are especially familiar with all the customs and controversies of the Jews. Therefore, I beg of you to listen to me patiently. All the Jews know my way of life from my youth, a life spent from the beginning among my own people and in Jerusalem. They have known for a long time, if they are willing to testify, that I have belonged to the strictest sect of our religion and lived as a Pharisee. And now I stand here on trial on account of my hope in the promise made by God to our ancestors, a promise that our 12 tribes hope to attain as they earnestly worship day and night. It is for this hope, Your Excellency, that I am accused by Jews. Why is it thought incredible by any of you that God raises the dead? Indeed, I myself was convinced that I ought to do many things against the name of Jesus of Nazareth, and that is what I did in Jerusalem. With authority received from the chief priests, I not only locked up many of the saints in prison, but I also cast my vote against them when they were being condemned to death. By punishing them often in all the synagogues, I tried to force them to blaspheme, and since I was so furiously enraged at them, I pursued them even to foreign cities. With this in mind, I was travelling to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priests, when at midday along the road, Your Excellency, I saw a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, shining around me and my companions."
"So then, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the vision of heaven. First to those in Damascus, then to those in Jerusalem in all Judea, and then to the Gentiles, I preached that they should repent and turn to God, and demonstrate their repentance by their deeds. That is why some Jews seized me in the temple courts and tried to kill me. But God has helped me to this very day, so I stand here and testify to small and great alike. I am saying nothing beyond what the prophets and Moses said would happen, that the Messiah would suffer, be the first to rise from the dead, and bring a message of light to his own people and to the Gentiles." At this point, Festus interrupted Paul's defense. "You are out of your mind, Paul," he shouted. "Your great learning is driving you insane." "I'm not insane, most excellent Festus," Paul replied. "That is, what I am saying is true and reasonable. The king is familiar with these things, and I can speak freely to him. I am convinced, and none of this has escaped his notice, because it was not done in a corner. King Agrippa, do you believe in the prophets? I know you do. Then Agrippa said to Paul, do you think that in such a short time you can persuade me to be a Christian? Paul replied, short or long, I pray to God that not only you, but all who are listening to me today may become what I am, except for these chains. The king arose, and with him the governor and Bernice and those sitting with them. And after they left the room, they began saying one to another, this man is not doing anything that deserves death or imprisonment. Agrippa said to Festus, this man could have been set free if he had not appealed to Caesar. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean, singing high. Shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me, it was in the garden, he prayed, not my will, but thine. He had no tears for his own griefs, but sweat drops of blood for mine. Singing, how marvelous, how wonderful.
And our hearts to your word, so that you may change us. Amen. Paul could not have imagined that one day he would be in the presence of King Herod Agrippa II. King Agrippa was the last of the Herodian kings. He was the great-grandson of Herod the Great, to whose palace the wise men went in Matthew's Gospel looking for the child born as King of the Jews. Herod the Great, you might recall, sought to kill the child Jesus in an attempt to keep hold of his grip on power. He died very early in the life of Jesus. Herod Antipas succeeded Herod the Great. He was the great-uncle of Agrippa II. Antipas was married to Herodias, who had previously been married to his half-brother, Herod II. John the Baptist's criticism of this marriage led to him being beheaded by Antipas. Antipas was also the king mentioned in Luke 23, to whom Pilate sent Jesus when Jesus was arrested and ultimately crucified. Herod Agrippa I succeeded his uncle Antipas by plotting against him. Agrippa I was the brother of Herodias. Yes, you heard that correctly. Antipas was in fact married to his niece. And her brother was instrumental in his uncle's exile so that he could become king. Herod Agrippa is mentioned in Acts 12, a chapter we did not explore in any great detail. And he persecuted the church, killing James, the brother of John, and he arrested Peter, intending to do the same. But Peter had a miraculous escape, and Agrippa I died shortly after that. So by the time we come to his son, Herod Agrippa II, given that family history, we have every right to expect that he will be as hostile to Paul as his father had been to James and Peter, and his great uncle had been to John the Baptist, and his great grandfather had been to Jesus. But not so. Agrippa finds that Paul had done nothing wrong and claims that Paul comes close to persuading him to become a Christian. Paul's response was wonderful. I pray to God that not only you, but also all who are listening to me today might become such as I am, except for these chains. Four things I want to draw out from this story. First, don't assume you know who people are. Sometimes we take a look at people and we think we know their story. Agrippa II is a Herod. This is a dynastic family that has been hostile to Christianity for three generations already. Of course he will be hostile. And yet, he was almost persuaded to be a Christian. We often assume that people will be hostile to the good news of Jesus. They don't want to know. If we talk faith, they will withdraw. But will they? Don't assume you know who people are. Our history does not necessarily define us. Second, don't assume you need a fresh angle. It's striking that Paul once again tells his story of meeting Jesus on the Damascus Road. It's the third time we hear this story told in the book of Acts. Paul doesn't offer a fresh angle. He tells the same old story. Why? Well, first of all, because it's a good story. But mostly because it is the only story he's got. We can only tell the stories we have. When I was younger, I often wished that I had a great conversion story. You know the kind. I used to be a really bad guy, but then I met Jesus and he turned me into a really good guy. Well, the truth is less interesting. I was never that bad a guy. I grew up in church and for most of my life was seeking to be a Christian. But also, I'm not that good of a guy either. I'm trying and often failing to be the man I really want to be. But that's the only story I've got. Friends, we don't need a fresh angle when we talk about stories of faith. We tell the stories we have because those stories are real and authentic, and those are the only stories that have the power to change people's lives and outlooks. Third, don't assume that one conversation is all that it's going to take. Agrippa was almost persuaded, but not quite. Imagine if Paul had the opportunity to spend 2 years talking to Agrippa, as he had with Governor Felix. If Agrippa was almost persuaded after one conversation, he might be fully persuaded after many. Some of our conversations about and around faith need to be repeated conversations over time. Perhaps we might persuade people then that faith in the risen Jesus isn't a sign of madness, as Governor Festus proclaimed. Rather, it might be the most sensible thing in the world. And fourth and finally, Don't assume that the person you're talking to is the only one listening. Paul makes a wonderful reference in his prayer that Agrippa will become a Christian, as well as everyone else listening. So I wonder, who else might be listening as we share our stories, particularly our stories of faith? And I wonder, who might we seek to have repeated conversations with over time, to share the stories we have, our unremarkable story of the risen Christ in our lives? Gracious God, give us vision to share our stories of faith, unremarkable though they may seem, and opportunity to share those stories over time, knowing that stories of faith in our lives enable others to envision the possibility of God in their lives. Amen. As we come to our prayers of intercession, if you're watching this service with me live on YouTube, please do add your prayers to the chat section. If you're watching this later on, the chat section will be disabled, but you can still add some prayers in the comment section below. And if you're listening to this on audio, by all means, please do add your own prayers as we go along. So let us, by prayer and intercession, with thanksgiving, make our request to God. Hear us, good Lord. Gracious God, we pray for peace, justice, and reconciliation throughout the world. We pray for the honoring of human rights, for the relief of the oppressed, and for an end to racism. We give thanks for all that is gracious in the lives of women, men, and children. Hear us, good Lord. We pray for the renewal of the church in faith, love, and service. We pray for the life of our communities. And we give thanks for the gift of your word, the grace of the sacraments, and the fellowship of your people. Hear us, good Lord. We pray for this local community, for all people in their daily lives and work. We pray for the young, the elderly, for families, and all who are alone. We give thanks for human skill and creativity and all that reveals your loveliness. We pray in particular for all working on a vaccine for COVID-19. Hear us, good Lord. We pray for those who are in need, for the sick, the sorrowful and bereaved. We pray for all who bring comfort and care and healing. And we give thanks for human love and friendship and all that enriches our daily lives. Hear us, good Lord. In silence, let us commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God. We draw all our prayers together. In the prayer that Jesus gave us in its modern form, the words will appear on screen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Paul shared his faith with King Agrippa, someone he should have expected to be hostile to that faith. The outcome was unexpected, perhaps even surprising. My prayer today is that we will be open to the unexpected and surprising ways that God might want to work among us, both now and in the future. Amen. And because that is the nature of the God we serve, we end today on a note of praise. Every praise is to our God. I really hope you like it.
One more time, every praise,
come now to a blessing. The love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service. And the joy of the Lord Jesus fill your hearts. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and always. Amen. Thank you so very much for joining me for worship today. I really hope you like that last song. And if we ever decide to have a street party, that's my recommendation. We're definitely going to have to sing that one. I'll be back on Tuesday this week as we continue our journey traversing 1 Thessalonians. I hope that if you haven't yet had a chance to join us for the Bible study, you'll have access to that information about how to join us on Zoom as we continue that study. I'll also be this week engaging with the first of our anti-racism reading groups on Thursday evening. That is now fully booked, and we're looking forward to reading Akala, but there are still some spaces available on Monday the 19th, where we'll be revisiting that book. So if you wanted to join the anti-racism reading group and you missed Thursday the 15th, you can join us on Monday the 19th, and Ramona and I will be looking forward to engaging in those reading groups later this week. Next week, Sunday, I'll be back here on YouTube, and we'll be celebrating communion at home. If you would like to eat something in your homes as a sign of solidarity despite our distance, you might want to be prepared for that and have something to drink, something to eat. You might also like to have a candle, and we'll be sharing in that service in a week's time. So I shall see you then. God bless you.
It's who I got.
It's who I got.
Every word of worship.
Every word of worship.
With one accord.
With one accord.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
It's who I got.
It's who I got.
Come on, everybody. Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah.
To our God.
To our God.
Glory, hallelujah.
Glory, hallelujah.
It's to our God.
To our God.
Come on, say every praise.
Every praise.
Say every praise. It's to our God. Y'all know how we do it. Take it up. Every praise.
It's to our God.
Every word of worship.
With one accord.
Come on, say every praise.
Every praise.
It's to our God. I want everybody all over the world to sing hallelujah. To our God.
To
our God. Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
It's to our God.
Let's take it up one more time. Every praise. Come on, everybody.
Every word of worship.
With one accord.
Every
praise.